Well, welcome back to Spring One, everybody. You know, I want to introduce to you Alexandra and Didier. They are going to have a wonderful talk on Welcome to the Metrics, and it's going to be a micrometer great time. And with that, Alexandra, Didier, take it off.
Hello. Thank you. Hello, okay. Everyone.
Hello. Welcome to this session. If you are into Spring Boot and apps running in production, you are in good hands. My name is Didier Burkhalter. I am a solution engineer at VMware. I am working in Tanzu organization. Those times I was working with customers, especially in manufacturing industry use cases.
Hello, everyone. My name is Alexandre Roman. I'm a solution engineer working at VMware Tanzu. I'm based in Paris, working with Didier as well. So my job is to help the customers use the services and products from the Tanzu portfolio, which will help you modernize your apps and using Kubernetes at scale. So this session is all about observability and how to build better metrics for your apps and your platforms. So first, we'll see why it is so important to have metrics these days. And then we'll cover some practices around app failure with some tips and tricks you can apply to your projects. And last but not least, we'll see how to build great metrics for your apps to monitor your business. But don't worry, although we are all virtual this year, this is still Spring One, so we will have live demos and source code. Please ask your questions in the SAC channel. We'll try to give you answers at the end of this session. And Didier, the floor is all yours.
Okay, thank you. So observability, what, why, and how? So a definition, perhaps a bit academic. Si tu peux. Okay. So observability leverage measurable characteristic of a system that enables to be seen, to be observed, so its internal state and behavior can be inferred from external interrogation. Observability is also the ability for people. Tu peux passer? Next, please. Okay. Observability is also the ability for people or tools to query a system to discover insight and get understanding of it. It lays critical foundation for reliability engineering practices. It provides human-centered data-informed approach, and it allows organizations to take informed decision and make appropriate strategic investment along the learning path. So the goals, it depends really on the teams and organization expectation. First and foremost, First and foremost is to understand and meet what the business intents are and what the business needs are. So it's the goal. Then it needs to the teams need to provide stable, performant, adaptive systems with very cost-effective and operating a good operating model. Next, it has to make reliability engineers and operation teams happy. The reality is that an engineer happiness and sustainability of system are closely related. Systems that are observable are easier to understand and maintain, which means it's easier to be an engineer who owns those systems. In turn, happier engineers mean less turnover and less time and money spent ramping up new engineers. And of course, there is customer centricity. So those systems have to provide to customer the best user experience. So the what? On one hand, you have the observables, the system, the components, the application that produce information. On the other hand, you have observers that consume data at the very beginning. The it's not information, it's raw data. The relationship between those systems is based on domain. So they can be system domain, for example, for system, very specific, or other specific domains, and three very well-known pillars. The logs, they generate generally produced by the application. The metrics, produced by the system, so mostly embedded. And the traces, they are floating around those components. And we see, in fact, two competing worlds that are competing for decades. On the left-hand side, you have developers that love to write code, and they do not care for next step. And on the other side, you have people that try to catch up the trends. So what we see is a big, I would say, big mistake between those two parties. So it's a misalignment on semantic between the producers and consumer, and also a kind of asymmetric, I would say, asynchronous relationship between those two camps. And this leads generally to wrong data interpretation and project latencies. Observability, so the how. On one hand, we have a lot of system to observe. And on the other hand, you have a lot of observers. And these observers are generally interested in those logs, the metrics and the traces. And the system tend to grow with the cloud-native architecture. We see clearly a tension on observability, cardinality. So how many systems are producing information? How many systems need to consume this information? So people to do observability, they leverage observability tools. And they are a lot on the market. And this observability tool has a lot of things to do. They have to collect the information. They have to process, to interpret, to transform, to filter, to filter the data. Of course, this data, they have to store this amount of data. So it can be a gigabyte of data per day or more. And with this data, you will build these different kind of dashboards. And the dashboard allow people to act or react. And for example, we have activities like alerting, like fixing stuff, fixing bugs, or fixing bad behavior, and scaling the system if you need to, for example, to scale up or scale down your system. And this is not a simple story. It's very related with big data activity, and along the processing, it looks like a MapReduce activity. And as you manage a lot of data, you can involve analytics to get along the time you can get trends and expectation about the future. So the how. If we put in context the observability, we have to provide our customer the best experience. For example, a good latency when you display pages or when you have a mobile application. So we have to align today two worlds, observables and observers. They are designed by human on both sides. Generally, those people do not talk a lot together. So to align those parties, we put in place contracts, what we can call, for example, at the beginning, service level objectives. But as we know that from the very beginning, we do not know what is really expected, we will measure in real life, we will measure what looks like the real behavior, and hopefully this contract will converge converge based on shared contract. And all this will be happen in good shape if we apply agile practices to bridge the sense, to bridge the meaning. And if we put this on good SRE practices, we will be able to collaborate, to modelize, to experiment, and to iterate between the developers and the people that are making the observability and the dashboards. So, and of course, put analytics. So, when your system are in constant evolution, the better you know your customer, you will add new features. You will have the better customer understanding. You will probably add new dashboard. This kind of virtuous loop. And now, why observability is so important for your business in more simple terms? Because teams who make apps have the knowledge to build useful metrics to track your business. You can enhance this motto. You build it, you run it, and now you have to measure it. Oops, you have to measure it twice. So how to drive your business? You have to scrape metrics from your app and your platform. So a good question is, make sure that the meaning of each metric is well understood by everyone. When I mean everyone, it's on both sides, the people that produce the metrics and people that consume the metrics. Use meaningful metrics. Ask yourself, what are the key metrics? What do you need in terms of metrics to monitor your business? And a good question is, perhaps it's a good or bad stories, but do you want to drive without gas or with the fire on board, are you willing to drive your boat in a good shape and to the destination? And of course, observability is not new. It's there for a while. So we have, or you have, a plenty of tools to measure your activities along your software activities based on very specific or dedicated activity. For example, a developer needs to know with a green sign or red sign if his build is okay or not. But the operator on his side needs to look for a CPU or memory or disk consumption. Unlike the business analyst, it looks like for the broader customer activity. So remember in old days, so it's probably one decade ago or two decades ago, JConsult was the ultimate tool we needed to get metrics from Java apps. And I see Alexandre that smiles on this story, and to look at the JVM behavior. I wonder if it's a problem to have so many tools. Alexander, what is your take on this?
Good point, Didier. The thing is, you should always focus on the customer experience. You should ask yourself, are my users happy with my apps? And if not, how could we improve the performance of my business? You need to rely on a full stack of monitoring tools in order to get the full picture. You have the app, the middleware stack, the platform, and the underlying infrastructure. And when your app is broken, when something wrong happens, make sure you have everything you need to isolate the issue. You may use several tools to collect all these informations, depending on the level of details and the user perspective. Just like Didier mentioned, a developer may not want to have the full picture, the full range of metrics, unlike a platform operator. So let's say you have an app in production with critical dependencies, such as an infrastructure, resources, and a platform such as Kubernetes. You'll make your life way easier if all metrics are available in a single tool. This will greatly simplify correlation between all these metrics. And let me give you an example to prove my point. So let's have a look at this. So here you see a tool. So this is Wavefront, which is a product from the Tanzu portfolio. So what you see here is some shopping application. So it's a pretty simple app. You can order t-shirts and we deliver these items to you. And as you can see, this app is made of several components. So I'm using Wavefront. And let's have a look at the shopping app. As you can see, there are a lot of metrics available out of the box. So you can see the number of requests, the available memory, and so many things, a lot of things which are displayed in this screen. We can also have a look at some, you can also build your own dashboard. So let's have a look at some custom dashboard that I built for this application. And you can see that even more metrics are displayed in the screen. So you see the application, you see a lot of metrics on the right side of the screen. You see the database. We see a lot of information available for you. Some metrics come from the app. Some metrics come from the database, from the platform or the infrastructure. And here you can see the number of transactions for my app. And as you can see here, the number of transactions is falling down and something is wrong. And we need to look at this because, if the number of transactions is falling down, then there is a problem with my business. So first, let's see if all the customers are affected by this issue. So I can select here on my custom dashboard and see if all customers are having the same issue. And as you can see, about every customer using my app are currently having issues with my application. So I know that everybody is having a bad experience. So let's have a look at the app instances. So I have many instances of my application running. And here you see, we have someone, the app 5, as you can see, has a problem with the number of transactions. So, so we know that there is a single instance having issues. So let's select this app 5 instance and let's see what are the metrics coming from this application instance. You can see there are a lot of metrics available out of the box. Where is the problem? So the nice thing about Wavefront is that I have tools to help me find the issue. And fortunately, I can use a correlation function, which is available in Wavefront, in order to find the root cause. So let's run this tool. And Wavefront will automatically analyze all the metrics. And we try to see if something is wrong with some metrics available in this application. So what you can see here is the number of transactions going down. So we already know that there is a problem with the number of transactions. But we also see that this metric, the memory available for my instance, as you can see, this metric is falling down. And there may be some issue with this application as well. So let's zoom in. And here you see the memory. The memory of my application is going to zero. So there must be a problem with the application. So it's probably a problem with the application itself. Maybe there is some memory leak. So let the dev team work on this for now. And let's go back to the slides. Okay, so you may use different tools to monitor different layers of your application layer. Using Wavefront allows me to quickly find the root cause for an issue because all metrics are stored in a single place. And I can run this correlation function to filter out metrics. So moving on to the next section. Let's face it, your app will fail. And that's not a problem. That's how application development works. You add new features, you deploy a new version, and then you find bugs while your application is in production. In this section, let's see how you can apply some tips and tricks to make your life easier when it comes to solving issues with your app. So we live in a distributed world. We all know that. But all apps are not created equal. Back in the days, we used to have a monolithic model. In this architecture model, you have a single process, and adding new code is easy, and you have a single artifact to deploy. But you know that scaling monolithic apps is hard. You may not easily create more app instances, for example, as monolithic apps are often stateful. And that's why microservices are nice. If you apply good practices in software development, now you have a way to scale up your application by creating new instances, for example. But using microservices will not solve all your problems. In fact, now you have new problems to tackle. Let's say you deploy your app to Kubernetes. Pods are managed by the platform. New pods are created as needed, and sometimes an app instance can be killed. Is your app ready to handle this? And what happens when you scale up your cluster? If you add a new node in the cluster, does your app benefit from these new resources? And what about distributed configuration? So now you have many app instances running somewhere in the cloud. How do you scrape metrics from all these instances? Do you really want to write a Prometheus configuration file with your pod IP addresses? Of course not. So your microservices will fail for sure. But hopefully you already apply SRE practices in your organization. You know SRE. SRE stands for simply restart everything. And it really works, trust me. I know a lot of people using SRE every day. But seriously, you have decentralized your app with microservices. You have a distributed architecture model. Just apply the same rules for metrics. A team making an app should also be responsible for exposing metrics. After all, they are the ones who best know the application and what the code does. And since you are running your code on many nodes, you cannot expect the configuration to remain the same. Pods are started and killed by the platform. So you need to be dynamic. Metrics from your apps must be discovered at runtime. You cannot rely on a static configuration file anymore. And last tip, stick to standards. You don't know what fancy framework or language your team will use next year. When using microservices, you have the freedom to select the best tools for your app. But when it comes to network call tracing, you need to wire all these apps together. And you may use several clouds too. Open tracing is a great solution to trace network calls. There are many implementations available. And for Spring Boot apps, you'd better use Spring Cloud for this use case. So take a look at Prometheus. When you deploy your app to Kubernetes, Prometheus can automatically discover pods by looking at these annotations. And that's it. No matter how many pods you're running, Prometheus will automatically scrape metrics out of these pods. Adding open tracing support in your Spring Boot app is really easy. Just add these two dependencies to your project. Spring Cloud will take care of instrumenting network calls you make with REST client or web client by adding HTTP headers under the hood to trace network calls. So let's have a look at some famous Spring Boot application, the pet clinic, but now with microservices. So this is a new version of the pet clinic. So this app used to be a single artifact. And in this example, this app is split into four components. So you have the API gateway and you have three services. And this pet clinic version is currently deployed to some Kubernetes cluster. So let's have a look at some dashboard made with Wavefront. So in this screen, you have my cluster, my Kubernetes cluster. So you see a lot of pods running in my cluster. And all this information is retrieved using Wavefront. I can compare different versions of my app with different clusters. I just have to select a different cluster, for example. And a lot of metrics are available, as you can see. All these metrics are retrieved live, as you can see. And this is all coming from my cluster. And again, a lot of metrics are available. And you can also have traces for network calls, as you can see. So you see all the components for my application. These are microservices, and you see the calls between all these components. So it's really nice. And all I have to do to expose these metrics is to add the Wavefront dependency in my project. So as you can see, all I have to do is to add this dependency, and I'm done. The metrics will be retrieved from this application and will be sent to Wavefront, to the dashboard. So, and in case you want to include metrics from your platform, your database, or your infrastructure, it's also really easy to do. Let's have a look at Wavefront. And here you see the integration options you can use. So if you want to retrieve metrics from your Kubernetes cluster, it's just a matter of click on this option and deploy the Wavefront agent. I can do the same for all the major cloud providers available. And a lot of tools and products are supported out of the box. All right, so Wavefront is awesome. You get so much metrics from your app, your platform, your infrastructure. But the question is it too much? Let's move on to the next section. If you attend SpringOne, chances are that you are already using Spring Boot for your apps. As you know, exposing metrics out of your Spring Boot app is easy. Using Micrometer, developers can leverage app metrics using the monitoring tools of their choice: GMX, Prometheus, Wavefront, etc. Make sure you only use Micrometer when using custom metrics. It's a safe bet. And think of Micrometer as a Java persistent API to interact with your database. Micrometer is an abstraction layer to expose metrics to a great number of monitoring tools. As soon as you start using Spring Boot, you already have a lot of metrics available: CPU, memory usage, number of requests, etc. And that's a lot of data. Maybe too many. But don't get me wrong. Having so much metrics available out of the box is really great. Remember, the more indicators you have, the better is your chance to find the root cause for an app issue. But don't forget the reason you're running your app. You want your app to have great business performance. So you want to make your user happy. Users don't care about CPU usage or memory pressure. That's not how you should drive your business. That's why you need to create relevant metrics for your business. And only you or the team making the app can build meaningful metrics for your application. So let's go back to the pet clinic application and let's see how easy it is to create custom metrics with Micrometer. So I have pet clinic application running on my laptop, and I'm running this application, and there is a link to some Wavefront dashboard. So let's click on the generated link here. All right, and then we can see the app. So let's select the custom dashboard I made. So okay. Oh, let's go back to this. Sorry. Should be fine. All right. So the Wavefront dashboard is loading. So here you see the metrics available for my application. Let's click on this. All right. So we see my application. We see the four components for my application. And again, we see the dashboard with traces. So if we go to the application, here you can see the famous pet clinic UI. There are a bunch of owners with pets. There are also some data already available in the database. All right. So if you go over there, you should see the data loading. The idea is to add my own custom metrics. So let's see how we can do this with Micrometer. So the only thing I need to do is to create a new class using the Micrometer API. So here it is. So this is a component. This is a Spring Boot component. So here you can see I am only using Micrometer API. So I can use these metrics with Prometheus, with Wavefront, with GMX. It's up to you. You can select the monitoring tools you want to use for your application. And then here you see how to create a custom metrics. So I want to know the number of pets which are in my pet clinic right now. So this is how you create a metric. And you see that I will create a number of metrics for each pet type available in the database. So here I'm creating a metric, and I will add a tag with the pet type for each animals in the pet clinic. And that's all I have to do. Wavefront or Prometheus or GMX will call the Micrometer endpoint. And when it comes to updating the value, this method will be automatically called by the framework. I don't have to care about the destination of this metrics. So let's create a custom dashboard. So I have to restart the application because I made a modification. So let's do this now. right? So the application should restart in a few seconds, hopefully. Come on. All right. So the idea is that as soon as the application is running, then the metrics will automatically be available for all the monitoring tools which are bound to this application. So in that case, I'm using Wavefront. So the metrics will be available for Wavefront. So let's create a new dashboard. All right. And in this dashboard, I want to know the number of dogs in my pet clinic. So the idea is to drag and drop a new chart. All right, so I want to use this one. Okay, and then the only thing I need to do is to select the metrics. So you know, you remember the name of my metric. It is petclinic.pets. And this is the metrics already available in Wavefront. And then I want to filter out the data, and I just want to select the number of dogs only. All right, and then I want the last 5 minutes. All right, and then you see the number of dogs. So let's do some customization.
A question, it's kilometers or miles?
It's good questions. I would add this emoji so that we can all remember that we are talking about dogs, right? Okay. So it should be easier for everyone.
Yeah.
Let's where is the save button? Okay, it is here. Why I can't click on this? Okay. And we should select the last 5 minutes. And hopefully we should see the number of dogs in the pet clinic. There you go. You have the number of dogs. And so the application, the dashboard will automatically get refreshed. So let's go with some live data. All right. And because I want to add more metrics. Let's select a ready-made dashboard I made earlier. So here you see the number of dogs, the number of cats, lizards, and birds. So as soon as you add new pets in your application, so let's go to this screen. Let's add a new dog, and you already know the answers. As soon as I add this pet, you know that the number of dogs will automatically get increased, because this information will be retrieved by Wavefront automatically for me. So as you can see, it is really easy to add custom metrics. The thing is, it is only you that can build these metrics, depending on what you do with your business, depending on what is important to drive your business. You have to add your own custom metrics. In this example, we want to show the number of pets because it is a pet clinic, and we don't want to we don't want to have too many dogs and too many cats, otherwise bad things would happen. So we just have to wait for the screen to get updated. So we'll go back later as soon as it gets updated. All right. So let's go back to the demo. So metrics only work if they are well understood by coders and monitoring tools. So first, make sure your metrics have a naming convention here. If you monitor many apps, you will end up with a lot of metrics available. Finding the metric you need is easier if you know how data is classified. But the most important part of a metric is its meaning. Take this metric, for example. We have an integer value for each pet type. But what does this value mean? Is it a scalar value? Is it a percentage? There is nothing here in this screen or in this code to tell me if it's an integer value or a percentage. So make sure you document the meaning of all metrics so that you can safely use this data for alerting, so that you can make the good decision for your business. So I think it's time for wrapping up the session, Didier.
Yes. Thank you, Alexandre. You have shown multiple kind of metrics. So we can say that better observability leads to better apps, that leads to better business. So with this, you will be probably, and I hope for you, more proactive and more efficient. You will learn and anticipate, learn on your failures and anticipate also failures. And with communication, collaboration, and action, through agility practices and trust between the teams along your software development lifecycle, you will provide better services to your teams and to your customers.
Good.
Let's have
a look. You see the number of dogs is now set to 5.
I was looking for this, yeah.
Yeah, so hopefully my code is not wrong. So I think we can jump to the conclusion. Thank you everyone for attending this session. If you want to try Wavefront, go for it. There is a free trial. Just click on this link and you can sign up for a free account with limits, of course, but you can just try the product and see if it does fit your needs. Go to my GitHub page to get the Pet Clinic source code. And don't miss this session. Make your Kubernetes clusters production ready with Tanzu, with Tiffany. If you have any questions, please go to the SpringOne Slack channel. Thank you, everyone, and stay safe.
Thank you. Merci.
Thank you, folks, for a wonderful talk. I learned so much about, I'm sitting there going, man, I want to try some of those graphs. They were totally awesome. Well, folks, if you have a question on metrics or micrometer, just go ahead and jump onto the Zoom chat that they have and be sure to ask your questions on the Slack channel. With that being said, we'll see you at in about 4:05 Eastern Standard Time. Thank you.